Yeah, this is hers in small, and then I made it bigger.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us to celebrate Barry's life. For those that don't know me, but I think I greeted you all at the door, I'm Carol McArton, Barry's wife. We've waited almost 2 years to gather in his honor and are very thankful that we can be together now. It means the world to us that you're here, in the Burney Theater or watching the live stream. Please be sure to sign the guest book or send us a text or email to let us know that you were watching so that we can add your name to the guest book. Okay. Music was always a part of Barry's life. At a young age, he was given a snare drum so that he could accompany his family when they made music together on Sunday evenings at his grandparents' home. He continued to play the drums throughout his life. He would tell us about playing in a band in his university days. Their repertoire consisted of 3 songs, which they played over and over throughout the night, and they were paid for it. I was frequently treated to drum solos that could conveniently be heard throughout our home. He loved playing for and with his grandchildren. So it really wasn't that much of a stretch when he accepted a position with the Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra. There he met Richard Turner, principal harp, and Yuri Hooker, principal cello. They very kindly offered to play for us in Barry's honor. Richard and Yuri have adapted Maurice Ravel's Kaddish for tonight. Kaddish is a hymn praising God, which is recited during Jewish prayer services. It's often referred to as the mourner's Kaddish and is recited at funerals. Richard, Yuri.
Thank you.
was incredibly beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Barry wasn't Jewish. He probably hadn't met a Jew until he met me and was welcomed into the large, loud Blankstein family. He was curious, respectful, and engaged. He loved the feasting, not the fasting. He would describe our trip to Israel in 2018 as mind-blowing, and he returned to Winnipeg and undertook new projects in the Jewish community. Family members would joke that he was the true Jew, certainly a better Jew than they were. Which leads us to Rabbi Alan Green, Congregation Sherezetic's Rabbi Emeritus, who is now living in Iowa. When we spoke after Barry died, Rabbi Green referred to Barry as having a Jewish soul, and he offered to write a eulogy for Barry. As Rabbi Green couldn't join us tonight, my mother, who our family lovingly refers to as Rabbi Marjorie, will read his words. Mom?
This eulogy was originally written by Rabbi Alan Green, and it is my honor and privilege to read it today. 2 years after the fact, the passing of Barry McArton still weighs heavily upon those who know and love him. At age 70, Barry was taken from us decades before his time. But while Barry might have been robbed of more years to his life, he succeeded in adding a tremendous degree of life to his years. More than anyone I have ever met, Barry was motivated by a deep love, not only for friends and family, but for humanity at large. He was possessed of a willing spirit to inspire and lift anyone or any environment in which he happened to be. Who is wise, asked the rabbis rhetorically, a person who is able to see that which is yet unborn. Barry had a rare gift, a kind of prophetic insight into people and institutions as varied as the Winnipeg and Vancouver Symphony Orchestras, Cancer Care Manitoba, Combined Jewish Appeal of Winnipeg, and Congregation Sherezetic, which is how Barry and I first met. We went out to lunch maybe three times over a period of 2 years. However, it didn't take me long for me to sense Barry's extraordinary gift of vision, his ability to see the positive potential within any given set of circumstances. This was his modus operandi. And wherever he went in the world, whether on the docks of Batula Lake or in his remarkably successful fundraising achievements, Barry had this magnificent ability to see the potential for growth and fun in any social or institutional setting. He reminds me of the famous saying of George Bernard Shaw, some people see things as they are, and they say, why? I dream of things that never were, and say, why not? And so it was with one of Barry's final visions, the renovation of Congregation Sherezetic. Lorne and Weiss and I had an initial meeting with Barry and Marjorie to present an idea for renovating the venerable Sherezetic Social Hall. There was a strong family connection, as Barry's father-in-law, Morley, had a direct hand in the design and the construction of the iconic Sherezetic Synagogue building, a significant, ageless Winnipeg landmark for more than 70 years. We made our presentation, And then Barry went to work. In so many words, he told us, "You are thinking way too small. You are severely underestimating the importance of Shaar Tzedek in the life of the Winnipeg Jewish community. Therefore, you don't want to redesign one room and leave the rest of the building untouched. There is unrealized potential here you can hardly begin to imagine. Please, let us meet with the rest of the Blankstein family, and we'll let you know what we think." A few weeks later, we met again. The visionary advice we received from Barry and Marjorie was to consult various architects and see what kinds of ideas would emerge. Suddenly, we were playing in an entirely different ballpark. Due to our restricted vision, we had been playing sandlot baseball. Now suddenly we were in beautiful Shaw Park. The best part was that we all had so much fun in the process. Barry's enthusiasm was infectious, and his practical laser-like focus convinced us that it really would be possible to rejuvenate the classic Shaar Tzedek building despite the obstacles. Thanks to Barry's inspiration, the support of the Blankstein family, and other generous donors, the synagogue renovation is now underway. The iconic external design, championed by Cecil and Morley more than 70 years ago, will remain the same. But the numerous planned internal updates will allow Shaar Tzedek to perpetuate Jewish life in Winnipeg for another 70 years to come. Barry's loving contributions of time, energy, and enthusiasm to the arts, to healthcare, to untold numbers of individuals, and to the life of the Winnipeg Jewish community will live on for many years to come. In this way, Barry's life is an example to us all of how we mortal beings can leave a significant mark in time in the hearts, minds, and memories of those we know and love in this lifetime. Those memories are deeply significant and they reside within. Barry may have passed away from this world, but on that soul level of existence, at the crossroads of heart, mind, and memory, he continues to live in a way that cannot be touched or harmed by death. And on that soul level of existence, which is beyond time and space, in truth, Barry is never any further away from us than the width of a closed eyelid. This is what it really means when we say, Zichrono Livracha, may his memory be a blessing. Our memories of Barry should always prove to be a light and a guide, an inspiration and a blessing for all who know and love him.
We know that you each have your own memories of Barry, but I think we all knew Barry to be both intense and goofy. I think that personality combo is best illustrated by the lengthy to-do list he prepared for Sid and Graham's weekend at the cabin. The last item, added later in different colored ink and in capital letters, read, "Have fun." With Josh Glow's help, we've put together a slideshow of some of our fondest memories of Barry.
Nibbling on sponge cake, watching the sun bake, all of those tourists covered with oil. Drumming my six string on my front porch swing. Smell those shrimp, they're beginning to boil. Wasting away again in Margaritaville. Searching for my lost sugar. Some people claim that there's a one. don't know the reason. Stayed here all season. Nothing is sure but this brand new tattoo. But it's a real beauty. A Mexican cutie. How it got here, I haven't a clue. Wasting away again in Margaritaville. Searching for my lost shaker of salt. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame. Now I think.
My Teddy is Grandpa. I'm going to give you a drum solo so that you can practice that.
Stepped on a pop top, cut my heel, had to cruise on back home. But there's booze in the blender, and soon it will render that frozen concoction that helps me hang on.
And now I'd like to introduce Barry's son and daughter-in-law, Ian and Steph McArton.
Good evening. I can't see anybody. So I know you're probably smiling, some tears and everything. So I want to thank my mom, who's held it together so well. I want to thank you for tying me in after the Jimmy Buffett, so my costume makes a little bit more sense. I wore this to impress, you know, for my dad, and I'm really happy I'm wearing this. And I want to curse you, Mom, for putting me after the slideshow, because I started crying before I even got up here. But first of all, this is a celebration of life. I want everybody to be able to participate. We always feel weird about clapping at funerals and things like this. Let's have a round of applause for the music and for my grandmother and for my mom so far. And if you feel like clapping at any point in time, please do. It could be in the middle of a sentence or anything. Can't see you, but I, Uncle Max, gotta be Uncle Max. One more note on my outfit. Poppy, my dad's favorite color is yellow, so I'm wearing yellow, and he loved a good board short, and I'm wearing a good flower board short. This is like the time where he dyed his hair blonde with me in the summer after grade 8, about to start his brand new job at Cancer Care Manitoba. And he didn't care. He did it for me, and he dyed his hair blonde so I wouldn't feel ashamed to do it by myself. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming to celebrate my father's life. This event has been a long time coming, and I'm glad that we can finally gather to remember him and hopefully not shed too many tears. I'm sure I will break down at some point during this speech, But believe me when I say that he would have wanted this to be a happy celebration. The thing that makes his passing the most difficult is that it happened early on in the pandemic, and I know that most of you had no opportunity to say goodbye. That can be a tough pill to swallow, but please take heart, because the last time you saw him, the last activity you had with him, the last project you worked on, that's the way he would have wanted you to remember him. This is why she's here, for emotional support. Barry McArton was a lot of things. He was an avid water skier, a great husband, an accomplished fundraiser and leader of organizations, a coach, hockey, soccer, water skiing, you name it. A manager, an adventurer, a boat mechanic, and on, but to me and my evil twin, he was one main thing, a wonderful dad. He was so incredibly dedicated to all of our endeavors, and he spent so much time, effort, and energy making sure we had incredible experiences that he really became a father figure to so many others. There really are so many stories I could share about him, and every time I'm thinking of one, another pops into my head. Stories of his countless career and volunteer accomplishments. Stories of his world travels and the Caribbean chapter of his life. Stories about his drive for success and his passion for positive change. Stories about his boundless energy and interest in everyone around him. Stories of his unwavering positivity and enthusiasm. I do think an underrated aspect of his character was his incredibly attentive to others, and he was very aware of the situations he was in. The best example of that is that he had a fantastic way of finding the person in the room who may not have been totally comfortable, like me at this moment, or an outgoing person and talking to them, believing in them and genuinely paying attention. That's just one of the many attributes I would like to take from him. In any situation my father was, he was always a bright light. Whether that was a planning meeting or on a paddleboard cruising down the lake, he was a major force and a magnet for conversation, camaraderie, a key part of the community, a helper and a driver, a lot of times literally a driver, of positive interaction. I don't think it's too bold to say that he never touched anyone's life in a small way. He had an impact on everyone. And you may enjoy hearing his life story, and I'm sure some of you will learn a few things about my dad tonight. Maybe you already have. I'm sorry, I lost my spot. But you don't need to know his life story to know that he was a wonderful and unique person, and to also know that in your own experience with him, whether that be a short time or a long time, you got the real experience. You got the full Barry McArton. Tonight, you're going to hear many praises of my father, but I don't want any of you to think that he was perfect or that his level of excellence is entirely unattainable. There are times in any person's life that are humbling moments, and for my dad, those would be losing a karate battle to 7-year-old Ian and going to the hospital for stitches, and also the number of times he ran out of gas in the boat. His obsession with the smallest possible slalom wake forced him to run the boat on minimal gas to avoid excess weight. He paid for that with many SOS calls and paddling the boat back to the shore. If you're looking to bring yourself closer to the spirit of my father, I have a few tips on how you can live your life the Barry McArton way. These won't move the needle too much, but you know it's something that he would have done. If you're at a restaurant, don't waste time reading the menu. Just order a chicken quesadilla. If you're thirsty, don't waste time with the long list of beers on tap. A Stella will do almost anywhere. When you find a pair of shoes you like, buy the same pair of shoes for the next 25 years. And always get a backup pair of ski gloves, or six, a backup propeller for your boat, a backup pair of shoes, in case you forget to buy a pair next year. If Poppy was here today, he would tell you that he was a lucky man to have lived the life that he did, to have met my mother and had his twins, to have been slaloming at an unfathomably high level until the age of 70, to get to play with his grandson Teddy and his granddaughter Rowan, to have such an incredible extended family, to be a part of Block 2 of Batula Lake, no offense, other blocks of Batula Lake, And on and on. Having said that, I can't help feeling sad about all the things coming up that he won't get to be a part of. But I think we know that his spirit and his energy is flowing around us all the time. As you heard Rabbi Green so wisely say through my grandmother, Barry is not so far away from us. He is only the width of a closed eyelid. We can relive the fondest memories of those who are no longer with us by closing our eyes and connecting with them. So let us all participate in a little exercise right now. I'm going to step out of the light so I can see that everyone's following my instructions. But please, everybody, just join me in closing your eyes for a moment and picture my dad. Okay, I see everyone's eyes closed. Keep your eyes closed, please. Maybe he's holding court in the boardroom. Maybe he's laughing at a big family dinner. Maybe he's playing the drums or on the sidelines of a soccer field. But let's keep our eyes closed, and I'm going to paint you two pictures. With your eyes closed, I see him right in front of me, standing on the swim platform of the Malibu. It's 9 a.m. in mid-July, and the sun is already hot. The water is glassious, dead flat calm. His vest, his gloves are on. His goggles with a homemade floaty are in place. His left foot is firmly planted in his D3. It's not his most recent ski, but this is my vision I'm painting. His eyes are scanning for fishermen leaving their docks. The rope is coiled in his right hand, the handle's in his left. His flowered shorts are cinched tightly. The engine roars to life. It's time to water ski. Now, this one came to me last night, but if you want to give your eyes a little break and open them for a second, you can, but we'll go back to closed eyes. One more picture for you. It's late January in Winnipeg. The sun set 5 hours ago, and the Nads have a meaningless beer league hockey game at Dakota Community Center. You finish lacing up your skates, you pull the sweater over your head, and you grab your stick. The boys line up at the gate, and the moment that the Zamboni doors close, you step out onto the fresh sheet of ice. As you take the first lap of warm-up, you spot one. As you take the first lap of warm-up, you spot one single spectator in the stands. The spectator has already collected. The spectator's already collected stray pucks from around the rink, and this is so sad for me, but the spectator has already collected stray pucks from around the rink, and he jumps to grab any that may leave the playing surface during the game. You're 28, moved out of the house, and married, so you only look up at the spectator a few times during the game. But he's ready to give you the thumbs up you've been looking for your whole life. At the end of the game, he's waiting at the gate, chatting with your teammates that he's known, watched, and cheered for nearly 20 years. After a few words about the game, it's nearly midnight. He heads for the parking lot with a final simple and perfect, love you. The spectator's my number one fan. He's my dad. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Jeff, but you have to follow Ian. Jeffrey Hayes, Barry's friend and colleague.
I hope Dad forgives me.
Good evening. It is an honor to be able to share some thoughts about my dear friend and colleague. My first introduction to Barry was by reputation rather than by name. In the fall of 1990, I had been the graphic designer for the Royal Winnipeg Ballet for over a dozen years. I was attending a marketing meeting, and the subject of the Winnipeg Symphony artistic director, Bramwell Tovey, a recent arrival from Sadler's Wells Royal Ballet, came up. A colleague remarked during the discussion that the orchestra must also have a new marketing director because he couldn't pick up a newspaper or turn on the radio or television without being exposed to whatever Tovey had been up to that day. A few weeks later, I received a call from Max Tapper, the executive director of the orchestra and a former ballet colleague who kept in touch from time to time. He told me about this new marketing director he had hired who he thought I would be extremely impressed with, named Barry McArton. I informed Max that Barry's work was already on the RWB's radar. Subsequent phone conversations with Max over ensuing weeks led me to consider an offer to join the WSO's new marketing team. An appointment was made for me to discuss the potential move with Bramwell and this hotshot new marketing director. I put together a portfolio of what I thought was my best work and met Barry backstage after a matinee educational concert that Bramwell had conducted. I first spent about a half hour with Bram, mostly swapping ballet gossip and discussing his thoughts about marketing the WSO. I was then led to Barry's office and was told he would join me shortly. The first thing I noticed while waiting was a large bulletin board with the orchestra's season ticket brochure pinned up. There were different colored post-it notes attached to every concert. I quickly understood that Barry had already devised the print and electronic PR media strategy for the remaining 5 months of performances. I was very impressed. This guy had a plan. A few minutes later, he arrived and with incredible enthusiasm described how amazing the WSO was, what a genius Bramwell was, and what a fantastic time we were all going to have working together. When he stopped for breath, I asked him if he was interested in looking at the samples I had brought. Heck no, he replied. You've been doing this for the RWB forever and they're successful. What else do I need to know? Then his face creased into an incandescent, impish grin, and he proudly exclaimed, "Now let me tell you about my wife and twins." Within those first 10 minutes, I had experienced the essential traits of this uniquely gifted man, which remained true for the 3 decades we shared professionally and personally. First, Barry never undertook a task without strategic analysis and preparation for any eventuality. He always had a plan. Second, whether as an employee, a manager, a consultant, or a volunteer, he was 100% committed to and enthusiastic about the product, service, or cause he had dedicated his efforts to. Third, and most important, he measured his success as a human being by striving to be absolutely the best husband, father, and grandfather. And he derived more joy from that than any of his other estimable accomplishments. Those accomplishments are almost too varied and numerous to inventory. Successfully launching the WSO's new music festival, strategizing and supervising the Bears on Broadway installation for cancer care, facilitating the weekend to end breast cancer fundraising walk, setting a Guinness World Record for the world's largest orchestra with the Vancouver Symphonies. These constitute just some of the high profile events he oversaw. Waterski Canada, the City of Winnipeg, the Winnipeg Symphony, the Vancouver Symphony, Cancer Care Manitoba Foundation, Variety, the Children's Festival, Winnipeg Cares, Rotary, the Philharmonic Choir, Harvest, Flora Philanthropy, and the campus we are gathered at today constitute an incomplete list of the organizations that benefited from his dedicated expertise and ingenuity. All of these accomplishments were achieved with great humility and self-effacement, always celebrating successes as a team effort. No matter the significance of these accomplishments, his greatest delight and pride was reserved for his family. Over countless, wait for it, chicken quesadilla lunches at Saucers, wasn't rehearsed, he would regale me with proud dad stories of coaching Sydney's soccer team, watching Ian playing and then coaching hockey, and of course, updating me on their water skiing progress at the much-loved cottage. He subsequently celebrated their successful careers, marriages, and eventual parenthood. One of Barry's last photos, which you saw tonight, portrays him gleefully introducing his infant granddaughter, Rowan, to the joys of maneuvering a powerboat on open water. The water was Barry's natural habitat. He spent so much time water skiing or thinking about it. The first time I saw him barefoot, I expected to see webs between his toes. He was constantly tweaking his boat, equipment, and technique, and would share reports on his progress with the zeal of an Olympian. A few years ago, my wife Barbara and I accepted an invitation to spend some time with Barry and Carol at their beautiful water ski retreat outside Indio. We never witnessed our friend Barry more content and in his element than during that memorable trip. It was through our friendship that we came to fully understand the importance of his choice of Carol as his life partner, a fact that he thoroughly appreciated and regularly acknowledged. His trapeze act career and enthusiasms were only made possible by the safety net of wisdom, calm capability, enduring loyalty, and consummate love that Carol provided. As I was forcefully made aware in that very first conversation, for him, his marriage and family were everything. If we are fortunate, our lives bring us in contact with a few individuals who are positive influences. Rarely, though, we meet an individual whose impact is transformational. For me and many others, Barry changed the way we thought about what was possible in any given situation. As was once said of the legendary jazz innovator Miles Davis, Barry ignored the word can't. His untimely passing has left a huge void in all our lives. Barry's indelibly optimistic, joyful presence continues to be sorely missed. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Well, Jeff made a valiant effort to mention the organizations that Barry was involved with, either in a professional capacity or as a volunteer. But I want to take a moment, actually it'll take more than just a moment, to list all the organizations that we could recall. Okay, get ready. You can keep your eyes open. CEA Simon Day, Sport Manitoba, Diving Canada, the World Water Ski Championships, Liz Allen Water Sports Center, St. Martin, Netherland Antilles, Kennard Cruise Lines, Pantages Playhouse Theatre, Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra, not once but twice, Variety, the Children's Charity of Manitoba, Barry D. McArton Consulting, the Consortium, consulting together with Jeff Hayes and Gordon Peters, the Winnipeg International Children's Festival, the Vancouver Symphony Orchestra, Cancer Care Manitoba Foundation. And as a volunteer, Manitoba Water Ski Region, the Gas Station Theatre, Osborne Village Cultural Centre, Agassiz Theatre Company, Royal Winnipeg Ballet School Committee, Manitoba Artisan Healthcare, Winnipeg Cares, an AIDS benefit, Harvest Manitoba, the Empty Bowls Gala, the Olympic Games. He was crew chief for long track speed skating. Manitoba Soccer Association, he was a board member and member of the FIFA Women's World Cup bid. He was a volunteer at the FIFA Women's World Cup in Winnipeg. He sat on the Asper Jewish Community Campus Board, became its president, and then a member of the Board of Governors. He was the committee chair for the Inside Ride, which benefited pediatric cancer at Cancer Care Manitoba, Winnipeg Philharmonic Choir, Jewish Federation of Winnipeg, Manitoba Choral Foundation, Floral Philanthropy, which he founded together with Henny Korn and Joyce Berry, the Combined Jewish Appeal, and the very early stages of Congregation Charizetic's L'Adore V'Adore capital campaign. Okay, I've blown his horn. He never would have done it. Thank you. Although every organization or project that Barry got involved with was important to him because he considered them essential to a community or the community at large, he derived his greatest pleasure from coaching SIDS soccer teams and getting to know a wonderful group of women who he once described as not a dud in the group. And he loved coaching and managing Ian's hockey teams, particularly when he got to manage teams that Ian was coaching. So the idea of teamwork leads me to Lewis Trepel, Barry's friend and teammate. Lewis?
How lucky are we to have known the most wonderful man, Barry McArton. Thank you, Carol, for letting me say a few words about one of my best friends I've ever had. I'm blessed that I got to witness Barry and Carol's beautiful journey together through life. I got to hear about all the excitement of their adventures, their joys, their kids, the graduations, the weddings, and the grandkids. Family life for Barry was everything. I am grateful to have had Barry as my colleague, my mentor, and my friend. I loved Barry. He was like my big brother. I could count on him when I needed creative input, someone to bounce around an idea, or a partner in crime. He was always there to celebrate success or solve a problem. Barry was one of the good ones. A fine man, so smart, interested, inquisitive, a little mischievous, and a lot of fun. In fact, Barry put the fun in fundraising. Working with him was never like work. It was about enthusiasm and passion for a cause. Barry's motto was, "I love to win." We even put that on his business cards. It was so him. Barry took great pleasure in getting things going, making things happen, helping an important cause, and honoring the teamwork that accomplished those goals. I've known Barry my whole adult life. I first worked with him 1,000 years ago when he was the executive director for Variety, the children's charity, and I was a volunteer. I learned so much as we collaborated together on countless projects over the decades. The biggest lesson I got from Barry was that when we put our time and effort into helping an organization, we must be able to see and share the essentiality of the need. How else could we engage other people for participation and support? Barry, with his eyes twinkling, could engage a room when he spoke. He could inspire an audience to action. He could move mountains. Many, many years ago, Barry and I joined forces with another dynamic duo, our friends Henny Korn and Joyce Barry. And we created an informal philanthropy quartet that I affectionately think of as the Dream Team. Because we achieved a lot together and had fun doing it. It was a dream to work with these people and all that positivity. We made magic together. And I kind of always felt that Barry was at our helm. One more lesson Barry taught me was that we shouldn't become stale. We should move on and make room for others to bring in new ideas. Just as we should spread our experience with a wider audience. That was part of the legacy that he built. He shared his gifts with many causes and thus made a much bigger impact in our community. In that spirit, I hope that maybe Henny, Joyce, and I can get the old band back together. Barry's moved on, but we will find a new member to complete our quartet and get back to business. I think that would honor Barry. And maybe that momentum will continue past our time here on Earth. In looking back, I'm so thrilled that Barry and Carol found their piece of paradise in the California desert, and that Barry could indulge in his other passion, water skiing. Barry's the only person I know who would go water skiing in the desert in the winter. It was always a highlight of the season to visit with Barry and Carol in our winter getaways together on foreign turf, in vacation mode, with no philanthropy talk. Well, maybe just a little talk. I miss Barry, but I'm thankful to have had him in my life for so many years. Thank you.
Sydney McArton, O'Bray, you're up.
Hi there, sports fans. That's something my dad would always say. It was his opening line at every single sporting event we ever played, so you heard it a lot. And for the longest time, I rolled my eyes, but it'd be nice to hear it again. For those who haven't met me, my name is Sid. I am the younger twin, whereas my dad loved to introduce me to everyone as the evil twin. I'm not sure how I got that, but I'm sure it was earned. Before I start, I want to thank you all for coming. Traffic was horrible, and as I was driving as fast as I could, all I could think of, my dad always would say, "We're not late yet. We're not late yet." And so I was like, "Dad, I can do it. I can make it." And I want to thank everyone who's watching online who couldn't be here today. We have friends around the world and those who are homesick. So thank you. My dad was an extraordinary man. He was generous with his time, knowledge, and love. And in 2 years since his death, I've been able to reflect on what I think made him so incredibly special. And I think I figured it out. He treated everyone like family, and he created families wherever he went. We had our actual blood family, the Lake family, our Indio family, his philanthropy family, and my soccer team, and all of our other friends. He showed up every day for his loved ones, and he knew how to approach the world with a positive mindset. Now, we all know how passionate my dad was water skiing, and he got us involved at the age of 3, but he was more than happy to let us find our own passions. It was through his generous volunteerism dedication to me that led us to soccer. Our journey started in grade 7 when we moved back to Manitoba. The community center called and said, "We have enough players to make a team, but no coach. And if you don't do it, they can't play." So of course he said yes. My dad spent countless hours researching a game he knew absolutely nothing about. We started indoor soccer, which was played then at that time in like a hockey rink with artificial fields. So my dad simply coached us as he would with the same strategies as a hockey team. We did really well that year because the other teams didn't know what we were doing. Good element of surprise. And he wasn't above changing our jerseys out in case someone was watching our team and forming strategies against us. And so many of those girls are here tonight. And then when I was a teenager, I had joined a more competitive level and Dad managed the team. And then he was able to take that youth team into the women's league, and so Brazil FC was formed. But what he ended up doing was creating a family. All of us players like the sport, but we love each other more. We've been playing together for over 20 years, and we're approaching another season. And it's hard to describe, but there's a certain magic about this team. We simply choose each other. Before my dad had passed, they made a video of what he had meant to them, and they showed up with flowers and food. And to be honest, I'm not sure how my dad put up with us. He was always focused and prepared, and we often showed up late without our equipment. We were more interested in talking about what we'd seen on The Bachelor, or some of us sneaking off to Holly's grandma's house for cookies during practice. But he loved you guys, and he was so proud of you in every step of the way. My dad showed me how to be there for your loved ones. He was the first to cheer you on in your victories and help pick you up when you fell. Even in his busy world, he would always check in on his friends and would say, "I was just thinking of you." He also showed his friendship and boundless love through tasks such as creating to-do lists for a certain very forgetful best friend, or shoveling your driveway or weeding your garden. When he thought you needed a hand, he was there to lend it. And so, for example, at the lake on New Year's, he called me at work and said, "When are you coming out?" And I said, "Dad, I'm stuck at work, I'm too sick to drive, and I'm waiting for my bus." And he said, "Nope." He wouldn't take no for an answer. And he drove 2 hours from the lake to downtown, picked me up, and drove me all the way back just so he could take care of me and we could celebrate together. He would say he would always do anything for me, and that was very true. Now, my dad used to make sure my friends and I would get home safely from a night out. He would say, "No matter what time it is, you call me." And he loved picking us up. Number one, he could ensure safety. Number two, he would get to hear all the gossip. And he loved his gossip. But this is one of my dad's favorite stories, and he was actually giggling about it the day before he died. So Graham, my now husband, and I had gone to a friend's wedding social, and I called my dad and said, "Dad, I won a TV. I'm drunk, and I don't know where I am." And he laughed and laughed and told me to go outside and walk until I see a street sign, and then he would come find me. So here I am, holding this big TV, walking down the street, and there he comes in his white Jeep, like a white knight, with a huge smile on his face. Now, my dad was an incredible public servant and shone at everything he did, but he was most outstanding as a parent. His outlook on life and mind frame is what I try to model for my kids. He turned the everyday mundane tasks into an adventure. This could be seen through finding quicker routes to places you always go, and he called them his Niki Dikis, When you would complain about having to do something, he would say, oh, come on, it'll be fun. And he made it so. And so when I try and channel this, when I'm going through the airport to get to Palm Springs, I, with my three-year-old daughter, I told her how my favorite part of the whole journey is to go through security. I just love having my bones scanned. And so I hope to keep that as long as we can go. And my dad would always say, get excited about one part of your day. And in the most isolating time of the pandemic, where my toddler and I barely left the house, this mind frame got me through the day. If you could simply just turn your mind from a negative space to a positive space, it would can change everything. Now, my dad made everything around him so magical, from making a tradition of howling at a full moon together to chasing moonbeams in our boat. He found joy and wonder in everything all around him. He made the holiday season so full of love and enthusiasm through telling stories at Hanukkah to his insanely wonderful energy on Christmas morning. He would be the first up and waiting very impatiently on the rest of us, often yelling, ho, 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 up the stairs at 7 a.m. He would have a well-thought-out and meaningful speech each year at Christmas dinner. And he was always imagining how he could make the holidays more joyful for our family, how he could one-up last year. That's why there's fireworks. And one year, he tried to organize a horse-drawn carriage and go caroling. We had to bring him down a notch because he never knew the words. But there was simply no limits for his vision. Now, my mom and dad created such a warm environment for our friends that our house quickly became their home away from home. Our friends were always welcomed and became part of the family. And everyone's names were shortened or given nicknames. And in fact, T-Baby, or Tommy Jakes, as we call him, is one of Ian's best friends. Now, Tommy, I have to tell you, Ian mentioned the name once. He said, oh, I'm going to T-Baby's house. And then he quickly tried to change it to a different nickname, but it stuck. And it's been that way for 20 years. So your room is named after you at the lake. And my dad had such a wonderful outlook on life, and he made everyone around him feel wanted and cared about. And this is my dad's biggest teaching. You must always tell your family how much you love them every day. And he never let us doubt how much he cared and how proud he was. Now, I have been devastated by loss before, but this one's different. My dad told me the day before he passed that he'd always be watching. And not a day has gone by where I don't hear his words in my head or feel his presence. I see him in my dreams. He always said that he would come back as a loon, and we see him as a loon where some of his ashes are at the lake. And he's always in the moon we love to look at so much. And because of this, I am at peace. I am so thankful for every memory in the life he gave to me. Thank you to all of our family and friends for being here and coming to celebrate the man we all love so much. Thank you.
So the somewhat formal part of our celebration is almost at an end. Barry would have preferred a reception that had tables overlooking the water with palm trees in the distance, and that served large plates of diet fries. But we think that ice-cold Stella, party sandwiches, and Nanaimo bars would be his second choice. So please join us in the multipurpose room after Richard and Yuri perform their adaptation of George Harrison's Here Comes the Sun. This was one of Barry's favorites and is most fitting as one of Barry's cousins described him as the sunshine in the room, which he definitely was to us. Thank you to all of you for being a part of Barry's life and ours. I owe a special thank you to Tom Bradley for introducing Barry and I. Barry and I shared an incredible life together. We often said that our greatest accomplishment was our children, and we were so happy to know they had wonderful partners in Steph and Graham. Add grandchildren, Teddy, Rowan, and Brooke, as well as soon-to-be baby McArton, and our cups runneth over. I am so grateful to have had such a wonderful partner whose love for me and belief in me continues to give me great strength now when I need it the most. Richard and Yuri.
Lights.